Morning series is a kickoff for the beginner series, which is going to be presented every Sunday with a new sermon title. Today's sermon title is Together, It's What We Do. It's What We Do. And we'll be talking about evangelism and the Great Commission, the five functions of the church within the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. If you will stand, let us honor God with the reading, the teaching, and the hearing of His word this morning out of the book of Matthew. Chapter 20, verses 19 through 20. Now I'm reading with the New King James Version. If you have your Bible app on a cell phone, you're welcome to open it. If not, just follow along the bulletin and the bulletin. Matthew chapter 20, verses 19 and 20. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to
God. Within the great commandment and the great commission, there exist five functions for the church. Five different functions. You notice what I love about this verse, it's first of all, is that it says, teach them to observe all things. It's not something that God is saying, and Jesus is saying, and our disciples are saying, hey, you know, God came up with this book. It's called the Bible. It's a good story book. You can just read it to your kids before you go to bed. If you really want to scare them, Jesus out of them, read the book of Revelation. Right before you go to bed. Or if you really want to read a good fictional story, read the book of Mark. And it's not that. It's a book of prophecy. It's a book of the word that has been brought to life. It's a book that we as Christians have committed to following and obeying and living our life as an example of. And so Christ has called us, and God has called us, that the word should be a light upon your feet. It should lead the path for righteousness. And again, amen. So the five functions that exist within the church of the Great Commission and the Great Commandment are this: worship, fellowship, discipleship, ministry, and evangelism. And through these five functions, we express our love for God and for our love of other people and for the person sitting next to you and those in your community. We do this by becoming clearer through our worship. We do this by becoming closer within our fellowship. We do this by becoming purer through our discipleship. And we do this by becoming stronger through ministry. And we do this by becoming larger by outward. But for some reason, for some oddball reason, and it could be because we are such a narcissistic society, we have become a church that is more concerned about ourselves. It's what can we get out of the church. Remember John F. Kennedy said, that's not what your country can do for you, or what you can do for your country. We reverse that. How is that what can the country do for me, and vice versa? And the church used to be the same way. We used to be a group of people that gathered within the walls of the building that God has blessed us with, and we would all try to find new ways to do mission and ministry within our community. And there used to be a time when the community needed to become a church. Can I get an amen? It was the churches that started the institutions of colleges. It was the churches that started the institutions of foster homes for kids. The churches have done so much more in centuries of past that has led up, but for some reason we've reached a wall that seems like a lot of that has become competition. And we're all in competing within each other, within our communities. The clergy don't want to invite clergy to their pulpits, and they're afraid the clergy they invite might be better than them. So they restrict who they allow in their pulpits. Churches had to hire choir members because members in the church don't want to do anything anymore for free. Everybody wants to get paid. So we have a hard time figuring out how we do ministry within the church. We seem to have abandoned three principles here: fellowship, ministry, and outreach. Those three, for some reason, have seemed to have fallen away. Recently, Barner Research, which is a Christian organization, does surveys within the body of Christ across the board in all denominations. They interviewed and surveyed 89% of the churches. And within that number, this is what they found out, which was the number one response of the majority of people. The question was, why do you think the church exists? The number one answer by the majority of people interviewed, 89%, said, it is to take care of my needs. and needs of my family. Simple as that. I hide, my money goes to them, and I expect that my needs are taken care of. And that my family's needs are taken care of. Only 11% of the people that were interviewed said that it is to win souls for Jesus Christ. To go into our community and take care of our neighbor. It's to go and reach lost people and introduce them to the love and the blood and the power of the salvation and the redemption of the blood of Jesus Christ and bring them to the fold and become Christians. Only 11% of the church. So if there are 100 of you in here, that means only 11 of you believe that. The rest of you may be, hopefully not. Amen? Believe that the church is here to take care of your needs. That's what we become as a church. Then the other problem is that we want to worship as long as it conforms to what we feel should be worshiped. God forbid I throw a new song out there, if you're not used to it. Or we decide to do a contemporary worship service. Or I have one church that literally told me this. If you bring drums into this sanctuary, you're getting kicked out. I said, well, praise the Lord, I don't want to leave the church anyway. I'll bring a set of drums here next Sunday, and I'll have to worry about having an appointment here next week. But they literally said that. If you put drums on this stage, right there, behind the black sheet, you will be kicked out of the church. I'm like, seriously? Did you want to read the Bible? I believe there's a text there that said that they read dancing with him, cymbals and drums and horns, and dancing. You imagine dancing in the sanctuary with all the non-Bibles? All happy. Crazy. They asked the Lord. They were thinking we were on those. They were like, that doesn't turn down there. Weird. Preach going up and down the aisle doing somersaults. Finally, that we had to get a hot one in the Bible. But seriously, what happened? What is wrong with us as a church? Excluding each and every one of you this morning. Don't take this personal. If it does hurt you, take it up with God. But what is wrong with us when the concern of outreach within our community is no longer the primary focus? Money becomes the primary focus. How much money we buy on Sunday morning becomes the primary focus. Have we met budget becomes the primary focus. Paying the preacher too much money becomes the primary focus. Paying the person too much money becomes the primary focus. Maintenance becomes the primary focus. We become an institution run by the wrong package. I've said this before, and I'll say it again, I never am concerned about money in church. That is the last time that you've ever been with yourself. The only time I even mention it is during the beginning of the year, January. Then I'm through with that. Because I never worry about the money. Because God, my Father, owns everything. By the way, He's the same Father you have. He owns everything. He owns the world, everything in it. He owns the streets that are paved with gold. Amen. So if we need it, He'll just take a gold brick out of that street down there and toss it down to the church when we need it. He provides all our needs. What we need to do is be faithful enough to have enough faith that our God, our Father, will take care of the needs of the church as long as we are doing what He has called us to do. And that's to be obedient and observe all things that He has commanded us to do. And evangelism and outreach is one of them. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 says this. The Lord is patient, not wanting anyone to be perished, but wants everyone to come to the repentance. God never wants anyone to die. He doesn't want anyone to go to hell. He doesn't want, it's not God's intention that you and I would be unhappy. In Scripture, He tells us exactly what He wants. He wants all of us to be saved. So when we think about the outreach and what God does, there's three reasons why God is so concerned about the church. And the first one, I just told you, is because God is concerned and God loves people. God loves every individual on earth. He created you. Look at your neighbor. Does she look like you? Does he look like you? Does your wife look like you? Well, some people say, you know, we're going to start looking at each other. But does your mate look like you? No. We're all individually. I don't know. I think Steve would look pretty good with jet hair and full black hair. I'm not going to say that. But we don't look like each other. All of our created individuals. God says that I've known you before you conceived in your mother's womb. I know every hair on your head. I have known you from day one. You have been created in the image of God. And God loves everyone. And it is His intention that not one person shall perish. and this great commission, and to go out and make sure that you introduce Jesus Christ to the world and those around you. Now that's hard to do if you're not following His words. Can I get an amen? If you're living like a hellion, Monday through Saturday, and you don't even reflect the image of Jesus Christ Monday through Saturday, then you can't go out and convert somebody to Christianity. They'll look at you like, really? Seriously? And this is what you want to offer me? This is what you got? This is the best that you have? Seriously? I can go to a bar and get that a lot better. And have a lot more fun with those spirits over there than these spirits over here. Can I get an amen? So we have to reflect the image of Christ. We have to respond as Christ has called us to respond. This is a church. And if we want people to come back to the church that they belong in, then the first thing we have to understand is that you are created individually, specially by God, created by Him, molded by Him. His hands were laid on you at the potter's plate. He took that mold, and He began to mold you, poured Holy Spirit on you, and anointed you to do stuff, and only you can achieve. And through Christ, all things are possible. So the first thing that we have to understand about outreach, the concern about outreach, is that God loves everybody. Period. I don't care who you are. I don't care how different you think. I don't care how much money you have, how much money you don't have. I don't care what kind of clothes you wear, what kind of clothes you don't wear. I don't care if you came from the opposite side of the tracks or the good side of the tracks. I always hated that term, that speaker. They came from bad for tracks. I don't see any tracks that have any side of the tracks. We're all equal. We're all created in the image of God. And God loves you because of it. The good news is that you have and I have been given forgiveness of all our sins. Our families have been forgiven of all their sins. And you individually have been forgiven of your sin. And guess what? So have a person next to you. So quit judging. Doing this? Everybody do this. What do you see looking at? Three things point right back at you. So doing this achieves nothing. Nothing. This does not achieve anything when you point your finger. Matter of fact, Melanie and I had, she made me laugh the other day. I walked in the house and I couldn't find her. I said, Melanie, where are you? And I'm over here. And she was out in the front foyer of the parsonage, reclining on a chair. I looked down at the bag of chips on the on one of the stools there, and I looked at her and I started laughing. She was like, tripped out, man. I had a bad day. I started laughing. I said, well, you know what? So how about I lose my lunch? And she looked at me and said, oh, I love you to say that. I'm just joking. Just joking. Just joking. She started laughing. And I said, no, actually, I just can't see what we do for lunch. So when we begin to look at people and we expect certain things or we demand certain things or we begin to point at them, we begin to judge them based on what their acts are, we forget that their sins are all forgiven. Can I get that? The Bible says that I forget all your sins. I remember them no more. They're blotted out. But yet we have a tendency to always remind ourselves of somebody that did something wrong or that wronged us. And then we won't let them forget that. And so we constantly judge people. God says that all people are forgiven sins. And I love all people. The second reason that we need to be reaching out to people is because it's called for in the book of Luke, chapter 14, verse 23. It says this. Go out into the country and urge anyone you find to come in, so that my house will be full. And Acts 1 verse 8 says, you will be my witness. You see, this church and any church never fills up through osmosis. It doesn't happen that. There's no business in the world that's successful just because you walk around and rub your shoulders. You may glean some wisdom from it. You may glean some knowledge through that, but the reality it takes work and effort to become successful. And if you want a church to be full, if you want the church to survive, be thriving, doing a great ministry, having kids, and having youth in here, having ministries that are reaching out to the community, each and every one of you have a responsibility. You can't just leave it up to me. You can't just leave it up to Steve. You just can't leave it up to the ushers. You can't just leave it up to the United Methodist women. You can't just leave it up to the United Methodist men, small groups of little pockets within the church. You can't just leave it up to Blake and say, well, maybe Blake put a dynamic youth missionary and he'll get all the kids to run out to the neighborhood and start beating on doors and fighting little kids. No, it takes all of us to do exactly what God has called us to. It takes all of us individually to go out and reach and target. It's to go out and in the country and urge anyone you find, to come into my house so that my house will be filled. Can I get in there? So the second reason that the Great Commission and the command is so important is because we are commanded to reach out to people. The third reason is because Christ has called the church to grow. It is His will that the church grows, not only spiritually as well, but also the mentality. But this, my concern is spiritually. If we don't have a healthy church, we won't be growing. Simple that. The church will not grow. You can't keep people that are visiting the church. It's spiritually, the church is the church. And things aren't right. So it has been my intention since I became the pastor back in July first, is to make sure that the church is taken care of first. Now some people may have a problem with that. And I'm not saying you individually, I'm saying the whole church. You see, we can't do ministry in the community if we're all everywhere. Amen? And if we're not structured properly, and if we're not in the Spirit of God and doing what God has commanded us. So it has been my intention since July 1st is to reorganize and restructure the church and have certain priorities that I have written down on a piece of paper that only Melanie and I have seen. For our eyes only. And I really believe this is going to take me a year to 2 years to accomplish every one of those ministry gifts and missions that I have set goals for. But I got news for you. This church has accomplished those goals in 5 months. So I'm way ahead of myself. Way ahead of myself. Come Easter Sunday, I will be celebrating with you in every sanctuary. Come Easter Sunday, everything that I had on the list that I thought needed to be done, that I thought it would take me a year or 2 years to get this congregation to do, we will have accomplished it all by Easter Sunday, and that is what, 7 months in the making? And you have done a fantastic job fulfilling those goals and those dreams and those ambitions. And I could not have accomplished every one of those without each and every one of you being committed to this church and saying, we're going to get it done, no matter what. And I've had a great amount of you folks that have come in here. I probably pushed more of your buttons than you can imagine, than I probably can imagine. You probably haven't shared it with me, but I'm sure I have. I know that that's my personality. I like pushing buttons, and I like rocking the boat, and I like tipping the ship over. If you get seasick in the midst, that's okay. They got medicine for that. Can I get an amen? But I like to push, and I like to just get people going, and I like to accomplish things. My only problem is that I'm impatient. That's my only problem. And I have to every once in a while, which is why Melody has been a great asset. Every once in a while, Melody will remind me, slow down, but I'm just going to say, grab the rein and slow back. Pull back a little bit. Go into the next. And every once in a while, she will remind me. So she's done a great job doing it. But we have done an outstanding job. And so that leads me to that third part, because church growth is God's will. It is God's will for the church to grow. Colossians chapter 2, verse 19 says this: under Christ's control, the whole body is nourished and grows as God wants it to grow. Matthew 16, 18 says, Jesus says, I will build my church. It is God's intention that his church grows. It is God's intention and it is his plan that the church grows. And it is God's strategy for church growth. And there is a strategy, by the way, in the Bible for church growth. You want to hear it? You ready for this? $1 million secret? You ready? In case you missed it, Matthew 28, 19 and 20. So therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Teach them all and observing all the things that I have commanded you. That is the plan. That is the strategy for church growth. Bring them into the house, building them up, not tearing them down, and judging them, talking about behind their backs. Not gossiping, not running. The serpent's tongue and slashing people with it. Building them up, not tearing them down, training them, not saying, here, do this, and you're on your own. Training them. Providing them the necessary tools that they need to accomplish their ministry. And then send them out into the community. Send them out into the neighborhoods. Send them out wherever you exist. And then bring them back. When you do that, you are doing what God has commanded you to do. Look, don't sit there and tell me you're too old. I don't want to hear that excuse. I won't buy it. I'm sorry. Where's Russell? life, 4x4, persecuted by himself, there's no excuse for you. I'm sorry. That may be a little hard. That may be a little rough on you, some of you guys, but I'm sorry. I know some of us have health problems. I know that. I've broken literally every bone in my body. I am the Christ heart coming for Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ is my superhero. And if I ever get out of the ministry, that's why I say ministry, by the way. If I ever get out of the ministry, my body falls all apart. My back will go, my neck will go, my arm will go, my knee will go, my foot will go. I'll probably drop a couple bones, a couple earlobes fall off. My body starts falling apart. I pray the Lord for Jesus Christ. He's my great superhero. But there's no excuse. There's mornings I wake up, I can't even straighten up. You can ask none of them. It takes me 45 minutes to fall off. Why do you think I get up so early? It's out of my devotion. It takes me 45 minutes to fall out. It takes me 2 cups of coffee to get energized in a moment. And after, by the way, after 45 minutes of walking, my feet are shot. My left foot has a bolt in it and a screw in it, this long, in my heart. If I take my shoes off, you can see the bolt literally pushing through the skin. Because I crushed my left foot. So when I walk for more than 45 minutes, if I'm on my feet for more than an hour, I have to pop, I can throw up 800 milligrams. To survive and function the rest of the day. So I try to wear as comfortable as shoes as possible, or try to scale off my feet. But I can't do either one of those. So my cabinet has 4 bottles, this big, with 800 milligrams of ibuprofen in them, just in case I have a rough day, which is pretty much every day. Right? So there really is no excuse for why you can't take this car. Pass them off to people you don't know. I mean, how hard is this? Chuck's over there. Chuck already called me. I have to tell him what my Chuck's saying. He's all excited. He's going to take me to his place. He's going to pass them off 10 people. When he walks in, 10 points. Give him 10 points, Chuck. Give him 10 points first. Oh, you don't? Oh. That dude, there's no reason. Steve O'Rourke, how many people you have at work? How many? 182. Oh, yeah, 182. 182, guys. There's no reason you can't do this. You can be 102 years old and pass out enemies. Can I get an amen? How many know? How many in this room? Raise your hands. How many in this room know nobody? Outside of the church. Let's see. Who in this room has no friends outside of the church? Raise your hand. There you go. How many in this room know 10 people that don't go to this church? Great. 10 people. 5 people. You're like, wow, 3 people. Wow, 1 person! Alright? You all know about it. So there's no reason you can't do this. You are commanded by God to do this. So where are you going to operate? Here's the tricky part. You ready for this? I'm not sending you to Africa or Ghana or Cuba. Or Spain, where's Chuck? I'm not saying, where's Chuck? I know I saw Chuck over there. Chuck, where are you? I mean, that all that is. I know you're going to be told, Chuck. Where's Chuck? Oh, that's right. I'm sorry. I'm going to Chuck. I'm not saying this is a third world country. Your territory is a fabulous, and guess where it is? Right here. You already know the culture. You already know the language. And you probably know most of the people. Amen? Amen? And you have a circle of people that you associate with. I've got a circle of people that I associate with, that I don't hang out, that don't go to church, that I ride to church. And I've got a group of people that, you know, I like, I ride a Harley with, when I invite to church. I've got a new group that I'll be joining next month. Actually, this month now, next Sunday. It's called Bikers Against Child Abuse. And I'll be joining up with that group now. And we'll start riding, and we'll start doing ministry to try to help raise funds for abused children here in this area and in the Brownsville area. So that's a new group that I'll be hooking up with this year. And so I'll be partnering with them. So we have all types of ways to reach people. We've got all types of ministries to do. It doesn't take a lot. So here's what I'm going to do. Since you already know your mission field, since you're already intelligent about your mission field and you already know where it exists, and you know the language, you know the culture, you know the people around you, the ushers will go ahead and come up here and start passing out the cards. So if the ushers come forward, they're going to give every one of you guys a wristband that says together. By the way, Georgia Bulldog is black. That's sorry, Pastor, all over here. It's a black band. Alright, you're gonna put the black band on, just wear it. Don't take it off. You leave it on for the entire month of March and up to Easter Sunday. Alright? You leave it on, and people will ask you, what's that for? Oh, let me tell you what our church is doing. Then we're gonna give you a package of cards. And each package represents 10 cards. Individually. Each one of you in here will get a pastor. If you're a husband and wife, you'll still get a pastor. Because the wives, believe it or not, guys, they know people you don't know. And vice versa, men know people the wives know, right? Amen? So each and every one of you will get a pastor. When they through this, we're going to get a communion service. Now I'll explain it to you. So you're all going to get a pack of 10 this Sunday. You're going to get a wristband this Sunday. You wear the wristband, you keep it on you from now on. Unless you want to take it off when you shower, that's fine. I can understand that. I'll just hang out. It's just saying to hold up very well. Then you get a pass off. A pass off to somebody, right? Give them off to somebody. All right, let's do this to. Yeah, let's do this to. Amen. Yeah. That is the thing. Together we can change this world. Together we can experience love. Together we can grow this church. Together. We can do the things that God has called us to do. Together, we can find peace within each other. But I can't do this on my own. This is happening involved with each and every one of you. So, for the next 4 weeks, Lord, we ask that you be with us and make us more sensitive to the needs that are around us. I ask, Lord, that as we go about our daily business, that you would open up to us opportunity to share your love with people. That we come in contact with. I pray that you give us boldness to speak up with wisdom and all those things. That you may take us, your people, and take our hearts and become receptive to the good news that we preach in Jesus' name. Amen. All right.